Welcome to NOAA Live Alaska. My name is Lisa Hiruki-Roing, and I'm going to be moderating today's webinar. This series is a collaborative effort by NOAA Fisheries Alaska Fisheries Science Center, where I work, NOAA's Alaska Regional Collaboration Network, and NOAA's National Weather Service. I'm also working with my co-coordinators, Story Oates and Neil Baldwin Schaefer, who will be helping me behind the scenes. This webinar series is designed to help you get to know NOAA's work in Alaska, our partners, and the communities we work with, and how we connect with your community. NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, studies the ocean and the atmosphere and where the two meet, from weather to ocean to the animals that live around us. This school year, we're presenting monthly webinars that feature our partnerships with organizations across Alaska. We're aiming to present perspectives from the communities we work with, as well as research conducted by established scientists and students. Today, we're introducing you to Alex Whiting, the Environmental Program Director at the Native Village of Kotzebue in Kotzebue, Alaska, and Michael Cameron, Polar Ecosystem Program Leader from the NOAA Fisheries Alaska Fisheries Science Center's Marine Mammal Laboratory. While we'll be talking about NOAA's and partners' role in research and stewardship, we want to recognize that we're all coming to you from the traditional lands of Indigenous communities who have substantial traditional and local Indigenous knowledge and much to share with us. Alex is presenting from Qikiqtaġruŋmiut or Kotzebue, where he lives and works. He works in the Kotzebue Sound area, which is home to several tribes of Iñupiaq people. We're grateful to the Iñupiaq who have stewarded their lands and waters for thousands of years, and we're indebted to them for their wisdom and knowledge of their lands and waters. We'd also like to acknowledge that Mike is presenting from, and we're hosting this webinar from, the traditional lands of the Coast Salish, including the First People of Seattle, the Duwamish people, past and present. Story is joining us from Juneau, Alaska, the ancestral homelands of the Occoquan and Tahkukpunka people. And Mabel is joining us from Venta or Wasilla, the ancestral homelands of the Nedina and Otna peoples. The community thrives thanks to the continued sharing of vision, wisdom, values, and leadership of these Indigenous communities. A few guidelines before I hand you over to our speakers. You're all muted because we have a lot of people on the line and we want to make sure that everyone can hear our speakers. However, there's a box where you can write questions, and we encourage you to ask them as we go, and my colleagues Story and Mabel and I will be keeping track for Alex and Mike, and they'll stop every now and again and answer a few questions. We might not get to all of our questions because we'll have a lot of people on the line, but we'll try to answer as many as we can. Okay, I will hand it over to Alex and Mike to introduce themselves.
Hello, my name is Alex Whiting. I'm the Environmental Program Director for the Native Village of Kotzebue, and I've been doing that since 1997.
And my name is Michael Cameron. I'm the program leader for the Polar Ecosystems Program. We study ice-associated seals and harbor seals in Alaska. I've been with the program for about 20 years, but I've been the leader of it for only a year or so.
Thank you. So the Native Village of Kotzebue Environmental Program, like I said, was started in 1997. And I want to acknowledge that its foundation for it is rooted in the Iñupiaq, which is a statement of values from the elders that they put down in the 1980s. And we follow that here in our own lives and with our work in order for it to be successful. There you can see the list of those values that are a good way to live your life, and the elders want to make sure that we continue to pass down those values. Next slide. Here's some pictures from the 1990s. My wife is Sikorok, is from the area. Her family has lived here for generations, and her uncle and aunt and her mom and dad and her cousins, I spent a lot of time with them out at camp, learning about the lifestyle of living off the land in the Arctic and being taught about how to think about success, how to have a successful way of hunting and camping and living out in the Arctic. And I brought those lessons with me when I started the program in 1997.
Next slide.
Yeah, next slide.
So we were asked to provide some photos of us when we were younger, experiencing the wilderness and wildlife and the outdoors as a way to show the ways that we have been influenced by others in our lives. These are photos of me from when I was growing up, still growing up. A lot of my influence from my love of the outdoors and my interest in nature in general came from my two grandfathers. My first was Edward, who was a locally famous sport fisherman. I grew up in Portland, Oregon, and most of my time was spent in the forests and hills and rivers and lakes and mountains around Portland. My grandfather taught me a lot about fishing in that area. My other grandfather, Bart, loved everything education-wise and was willing to indulge every whim and fantasy I had for being outdoors, whether that included getting lessons on horseback riding, scuba diving, or even beekeeping. He was willing to help support me in my growth and interest. My family in particular, my father John Cameron and my mother Vicki Cameron, were also avid backpackers and outdoors people. We spent a lot of time outside, river rafting, camping, and the such, mostly in desert areas. I'd like to, next slide. And I'd like to think that I'm continuing that with my own family. This is my wife, Colleen. She's from Texas, and I'm in the process of continuing to introduce her to outdoorsy adventure sports and the fun of being outdoors. My son, Colin Cameron, and my daughter, Kate Cameron. I was fortunate, our family was fortunate to have forged a lot of bonds and relationships with Alaska Natives, in many ways through my connection with Alex Whiting and Kotzebue. My son, Colin Cameron, was given the Iñupiaq name, Anawe, from John Goodwin, who lives in Kotzebue. And my daughter was given the name Siletkotok, from Billy Adams in Uptiavik. I'm very excited to be talking to you, especially because it allows me to also provide information that I've gained. I think we all learn the more that we share, and that's something that I've definitely learned working with Alex.
Now, here's a picture of Kotzebue Sound. In Kotzebue, you can see it's located on the Baldwin Peninsula, which is in the northern part of the sound. And the other map is a picture of from the 1800s of traditional Iñupiaq territories. And the Qikiqtaġruŋmiut, or the people of Qikiqtaġruŋ, which is Iñupiaq for almost an island, which describes the Baldwin Peninsula, which is now the location of Kotzebue, is the area that we focus a lot of our research on, although we go all over Kotzebue Sound and into the Chukchi Sea. But this just gives you an idea of the area that we're talking about. And then the Selwyn, Kobuk, and Noatak rivers all flow into the Kotzebue Sound from behind the peninsula there. And so all that water gathers together in the north side of the peninsula and flows out past Kotzebue, which provides a lot of nutrients for the fish and the animals like seals that we'll be talking about today, and the reason why seals are so abundant in Kotzebue Sound. Next slide. Here's a copy of a journal. It's something I started back in 2002, taking notes every week about the weather and then about travel conditions and any kind of hunting, fishing, or other activities that go on. And that's something that everyone can do. And you never know what you may use it for, but once that week has passed, you can never go back and recreate that kind of notes. So anyone that's interested in your area of taking notes about what's happening, that's a very good exercise to do. And it may help you in the future for any number of reasons. This journal here has helped when we do research. It's easy for us to identify the places and times that may be best for doing things like catching a ring seal or catching a spotted or a bearded seal from the notes that we take.
And I'll also agree with that. These journals that Alex has been able to maintain and keep and create have been invaluable in helping us understand lots of things. A single data point is useful, but having lots of data points regularly for a long period of time allows us to help understand trends and changes. We don't always know what's going to be important, but having a naturalist like and a scientist like Alex being able to look out and record what he views as important allows us the possibility of going back to those data sets and mine them for very useful information, very valuable.
Yeah. So I would just encourage everyone that if you're interested in the outdoors and what's happening in your community and you like to write, I would definitely encourage anyone to start journals and just see how it progresses and what you may use it for further on. I'm sure it'll come in handy for all kinds of different school exercises and even future jobs. So I just encourage that. Thank you. Next slide. Here's a picture of, you can see in the bottom there, that's a adult bearded seal, probably like, I don't know, 3 or 4 year old actually, but that's what a bearded seal looks like. The three graphs show that from a harvest survey we did at the tribe here in 2002, 2003, and 2004, that 70% of the food that people harvest around here comes out of Kotzebue Sound. It's either fish or marine mammals. The marine mammals is the yellowish kind and the fish is the bluish kind. And then in the upper right hand corner, you can see hunters dragging an uguruk onto the beach. That's one of our camps down the coast. And there's my wife, Sikra, catching sheafish in the springtime. This time of year, we'll start catching lots of sheafish when it's nice out. Next slide. So this is the first project we'll talk about. In 2003, I connected with Kathy Frost, a retired ADF&G biologist who was interested in trying to put satellite tags, which are somewhat new at this point, try to catch bearded seals and glue satellite tags to them so we could track where they go and their diving behavior and other kind of behaviors. It's something that she had wanted to do her entire career, but never got a chance to. And with a Fish and Wildlife funding mechanism in 2003, there was an opportunity to get funds to try to do that. And so me and her, along with Willie Goodwin, Ross Schaefer, and then John Goodwin, all tried to figure out how we go about catching bearded seals. One of the ideas was to use a big gill net like you use for salmon, but made out of twine instead of monofilament, and have light lead lines and a big float line instead of cork. So the seals, if they got tangled in it, could still easily breathe because, of course, we wanted them alive. And then when the project got funded and we started planning for it, we wanted to have a NOAA cooperator on the project. And that's where Michael Cameron came in, if you want to talk a little bit about that.
Sure. So that's me in the lower left there corner, free beard, I guess. This was one of my first experiences to be working north of the Arctic Circle, and one of my first to be handling bearded seals. I remember some of the early conversations that we had when we're trying to plan the field season and the best ways to capture them. Being some of the first times that these seals had ever been captured, it required a lot of conversation and a lot of thought. And obviously the folks with the best ideas are the folks that were living in the area who rely on these species for their livelihood. My memory, Alex, correct me if I'm wrong, is that there were discussions with some of the elders who the hunters and the elders recognized that there were increasing numbers of young bearded seals around the river mouths in the fall as the ice was starting to form. And then there was a memory that these sorts of nets had been used in one way or another for subsistence hunting. So by placing some of these nets perpendicular to the shore near the river mouths, we had the best opportunity for capturing seals. And lo and behold, that's what we found. Of course, we were able to refine the techniques as things went, but it was just this wealth of knowledge, the communication, the cooperation with everyone bringing their own expertise to the table, which made this a very successful project and long-term project.
Yeah. And Mike, just to clarify things, you had said that you set the nets were set perpendicular to the shore. That means that they were at right angles. Is that right? They're not the same direction as the shore. They were sort of like a fence that divided the shore.
That's correct. The idea being that folks had seen seals kind of moving along the shore. And so by placing the net like a fence at right angles to the shore, we had a good chance of being able to potentially capture some animals.
Yeah. And then we ended up, the project continued for how many years, and what ended up happening was Cyrus Harris, a Sisolic elder, and John Goodwin, a Kotzebue elder, they would have their own field teams out there, and they would camp out there, and they would set the nets and tend the nets, and they got all the training on how to handle the seals and even to take blood and things like that from the seals for specimens. And also everyone learned how to take the seals. And so we had a couple of local Iñupiaq teams, campers, that tended the nets for 3 to 5 weeks every fall going forward. But the first fall was in 2004 when we were actually in Kobuk Lake, and then we had moved the next year over to the Sisolic Peninsula where people had camps and it was easier to stay for a longer period of time and catch seals.
Should I go to the next slide then?
Yeah, next slide. Sorry. And so here you see Docky Harris and John Goodwin holding the ring seal pup there, and then Docky Harris and his uncle Lee Harris putting a tag on a ring seal there. And the tags were put on with 5-minute epoxy, and we put just enough epoxy so they would be glued to the hair. And then when the seal molts the next spring, so this is in the fall time, the tag will stay on all winter. And then the next spring, when every year seals grow new hair, they molt. And when the hair falls out, then the tag should fall out if you didn't put too much glue on. So that's how the tags work. You understand? Next slide.
So here we can start a video. Do you want to talk a little bit about the video before we see it, or while I'm setting it up here?
Well, this is a video of bearded and ring seal capture that was actually with the Department of Fish and Game later on in the springtime. And we had similar groups of people. John Goodwin was still involved at that time. And so we had a lot of local people still using their experience now of catching and taking seals to continue on with this work for how many years. So also this is a picture.
So I will start the video, and I'll just remind you guys that once the video starts that it'll mute you. So if you want to talk while the video is going on, remember to unmute yourself. So here we go.
So this is a young bearded seal that they just captured. That's a tube to take blood, a syringe to take blood. And then, of course, we weigh the seals, we measure the seals, and I was putting the epoxy on the tag and then letting the seal go back. Happy to get away from us. Most of the seals, after we tagged them, actually, they swim straight out into the Chukchi Sea. They don't stick around in Kotze, at least in the fall time anyways. They never really stuck around the tagging area. After we captured them and let them go, almost all of them, for the most part, would go straight out into the Chukchi, or at least way away from where they had gotten captured and tagged.
Okay, so now I will show the video of the male bearded seal movements, just to show where they went.
So each of these...
I think it's going to mute you once we start.
All right. Each of these colored lines is a different seal. And you see some go north and some go straight out, and then most of them go south. And you can see as the winter progresses, most of them follow down on the ice edge. And this is all over relatively shallow water, so they can still find food. But then the ice really never goes over the very deep part of the Bering Sea. But that's what that video shows.
All right, and then I think that we were going to show a ring seal video as well. But did you want to talk about some of these pictures before we watch the ring seal video?
Well, after we had a couple years of success capturing and tagging young bearded seals, we also thought it would be valuable to learn more about ring seals. And so we used the same techniques the same time of year when ring seals and young bearded seals are together. And we are tagging and capturing both ring seals and young bearded seals. And that's what those pictures show, some of the ring seal captures.
Okay, and I am going to go ahead and start the video of the ring seal movements. I did see in the comments that some people are having trouble seeing the video, so when the video screen comes up, sometimes it will come up behind your window, so you may have to click a tab or click behind your window to see whether the video can come up. And let me just start the ring seal movement one here. Here we go.
And so the interesting thing we learned about the ring seal that was somewhat known but hadn't really been documented because nobody had tagged this many ring seals in the fall time is that the young ring seals were also going right down to the ice edge while the larger, more mature ring seals were generally staying more northerly in preparation for breeding. They would winter. A lot of them would winter in Kotzebue Sound or the Chukchi Sea, whereas the young ones, almost all of them, would go down to the ice edge in the Bering Sea and winter down there, eating and growing and getting ready to be mature ring seals. So that was the major finding out of our ring seal research, was documenting that.
Very cool. Okay, so... we were going to talk a little bit about the results, so I will hand that over to Mike.
Sure. So the satellite tags that we're attaching to these animals, they collect a lot of different types of data. In addition to the movement data, where they're going day to day or season to season that Alex mentioned, at the same time, they're also collecting information on their diving behavior and also on their haul out. Their diving behavior records information like how frequently they dive, how long that they dive for, if they're diving to the bottom, or if they're kind of foraging more in the mid-water areas. And that information is really useful for folks to understand how they're using their habitat. We call that habitat use research. And from that, we can get ideas about what habitat may be important to them, or perhaps if we know what fish or prey there might be at those different locations, we can make inferences about what they might be eating. There's lots of other ways to get at those data too. And so by combining different methods to try and collect the same data, we can be more confident in our findings and also learn from the different types of data collection. The other type of data that I mentioned was haul out. These are all bearded and ring seals that we've been talking about so far. They're both collectively known as ice seals or ice associated seals. What that means is that these animals are known to be next to, near, or use ice for certain parts of the year or for certain parts of their life history. When an animal hauls out onto the top of sea ice, it's called hauling out. And we like to know, it's important for us to know the timing of when animals are choosing to haul out on top of the ice and when they're planning to go back into the water. We know that there are, from these studies, we know that there is a relationship to season. They will haul out more in the springtime, and we know that they'll haul out more midday when the sun is higher up in the sky. There's lots of other variables involved, but these two bits of information, along with lots of data samples, can allow us to create an estimate of how many animals the proportion of animals that might be on top of the ice at any one time. That's very useful for us at NOAA when we conduct aerial surveys, when we fly over large sections of the Chukchi Sea or the Bering Sea or the Beaufort Sea. We're collecting information, we're counting every seal that we see. We know that we can only see seals that are hauled out on top of the ice, and so we need to be able to understand or estimate how many seals are in the water. If we can estimate that half of the seals, for example, are in the water whenever we're flying over, then we know that we can multiply the number of seals we count by 2 to get a better estimate of the total population of the area. Of course, there's a lot more complicated math involved, but it just shows one more way that these satellite tags are incredibly useful for us, and the data that we're able to get from them really helps us to understand how these animals live and move within their ecosystems.
All right, well, I think we have some questions that are coming up. So I want to encourage our viewers that if you have any questions, to please type them into the question box, because this is the time that we'll take a few questions before we move on. But we did have a question from, from Ms. Ravenscroft's class in Akutan. They were asking, do you hunt the seals? And if you do, what do you do with the whiskers?
The Iñupiaq of Kotzebue hunt the seals. The bearded seal is the only second to caribou in the amount of weight of food that is gathered from the countryside. So the bearded seal is very important. And the ring seal is the only marine animal for the most part during the winter time. So if people want to hunt seals or have fresh seal oil, then they go out during the winter time. But yes, bearded and ring seals are hunted by lots of our people. And the whiskers are in fact used by some artists to create earrings now. The bearded seal whiskers, they're not as thick as walrus whiskers, but they're pretty thick and substantial. So some artists have created earrings out of bearded seal whiskers.
I'll say that on the scientist perspective, whiskers are also very useful. Whiskers, in a way, are able to help record the food that the animal eats. The chemical signatures of the whisker change based on the food that the animal takes in, and we can relate those chemical signatures to possible prey that they're eating. Because we know how the whiskers grow, and because they actually have rings similar to a tree, we can actually tell how far back in time that we're sampling a whisker, and we can tell from these whiskers and careful analyses how their diet may change from season to season, or even from year to year. So whiskers can have lots of purposes.
That's really interesting. And Mrs. Ravenscroft's class was also saying that they use whiskers for Aleut visors. They use them when they are making the visors, they put the whiskers on them. So that's another use, very artistic as well. And then they also had said that several years ago they had seen a ring seal on the beach of Akron Island. So that's very interesting as well. And one more question from Mrs. Ravenscroft's class was, they were wondering, does each color on that map represent a single seal that's been tagged, when you were showing the colors that were moving around?
Yes, each seal had its own color for the purpose of the animated sea ice and movement map.
Very cool. And then Jesslyn was wondering, how do you put a tracker on the seal? So Alex, you were mentioning that you you had, you were spreading something on the a satellite tag, but can you tell us in a little bit more detail how those trackers are put on?
Yeah, I guess our video is a little bit short and too much. So there's 5-minute epoxy, just like you buy at the hardware store. That 5-minute epoxy means that when you mix the two chemicals together, that they harden in 5 minutes. And when you're mixing them, they're sticky like honey and spreadable. And so you just use a stick, a tongue depressor, and you have the tag. And originally we used webbing on the tags, so we make sure they'd have a good surface area to stick to the fur or the hair of the seal. And so we first we would use a magic marker, put the tag where we wanted it, draw a little line around the tag on the seal, and then put some epoxy inside that circle, which from the magic marker, and then stick the tag on, and then add more epoxy on top of that. And we would do all this within a couple of minutes to make sure that we didn't take too long. And then that we would hold it there and hold the seal and keep them still for a few more minutes until it hardened. And then once it's hardened, it just stays hardened until the next spring when the hair molts off and the tag falls off.
And then Ms. Cooper's class from Kotzebue was wondering, on average, how long does the tracker stay on the seal?
I think it was like 8 months, something like that. And the more you do it, somewhat the better you get. But I believe, if I remember right, looking at least some of the data, I mean, every year it was a little bit different depending on the number of animals and how many survived through the winter. I mean, the seals die, especially young ones, for various reasons, from polar bears or ice, get caught in ice collapses and other things. But I believe, if I remember correctly, it was somewhere in the neighborhood of 8 months, year in and year out, for all the tags that we put.
Very cool. And then got a couple more questions. I know that you have a lot more stuff to talk about, so we'll keep it to a few more. But Ms. Hagen was wondering, do you retrieve the sensors after the seals molt or if they die?
Oh, no. So we never had an opportunity to get a tag back. A couple of our tags actually, we believe, ended up with hunters in Russia, but we never heard anything back from Russian side. And I don't believe any Alaska-based hunters ended up with our tags, or at least none that were reported, if I can remember right. And so,
There was one young bearded seal with a what's called an oceanographic tag. That animal was hunted about a month after it was released, and we got that tag back. That was actually very useful. This was a different type of a satellite tag than some of the pictures you've shown, Alex. This was a tag that was shown later in the season, later in our project, when we were getting more comfortable with it. This type of a tag, in addition to sampling location and haul out and depth, it was also sampling the water column. So we were getting salinity and temperature values as the animal was diving. The difficulty with that is that it takes a lot of energy to transmit that information back to a satellite. So the fact that we got the tag back from a hunter where we could download all the stored data meant we got a full record from that animal. So that was kind of exciting. But that was just the only one that I can think of that we got the tag back.
Great. We have a couple questions from the Hooper Bay Charter Schools. Calla, who's a grade 6 student, wanted to know, and actually this was a question that was also asked by Amanda, does climate change affect the populations of seals in Alaska? And I know that's a big question, so if you want to say we'll talk about that a little later on, that's fine, or if you want to give a quick answer now, that's fine too.
You have an answer, Alex. Go ahead. I'll go after you.
Well, I mean, I would just say that. So right now, it's not clear that any of the populations have been affected. But what we do know is that the change in ice conditions makes it a lot harder, especially for ring seals, to find breeding areas with sufficient ice and snow. And also in areas like Kotzebue Sound, we've had a couple of years where there's very little ice proportionally in the entire sound. So definitely the habitat for seals to haul out and to find food during the winter and also to have pups successfully in the springtime has become more challenging, but it's not clear, at least to me anyways, that it's actually affected the populations at this point.
I couldn't have said it better myself. I'll just add that it's the continuous collection of data, these time series, whether they're the journal entries that Alex was talking about at the beginning, or repeated capturing, sampling, tagging, repeated aerial surveys that are going to allow us to best answer that question. That is the number one question that I think we are most interested in, is being able to know how changes in climate will ultimately be affecting these animals, given that they use sea ice for an important part of their life. One can expect that there could be some impact, but we don't exactly know what those impacts are as the amount of sea ice changes over the next decades or so. So stay tuned. We'll all find out together.
I would add that NOAA formally expects it to impact the populations. That's why ring seals and bearded seals are now listed as threatened under the Endangered Species Act, is because it's their expectation that it will in fact affect the population at the population level in the future from climate change in particular. Right.
So I have one last question from Hooper Bay. Kaylin is a grade 6 student, and they're saying, we're into subsistence hunting. We hunt based on our needs. Are we causing some rapid decline of seal population, if there is any? Fiona?
No. The short answer is no. At this point, keep on hunting. Whenever you have opportunities to hunt and eat seals in your neck of the woods, there's no problem at this point with continued hunting as freely as people can use those animals for food and other needs.
Yes, you heard Alex mention that two of the species are currently listed as threatened under the Endangered Species Act, but there's no reason, no expectation that subsistence hunting by Alaska Natives is negatively impacting the population.
So keep hunting.
Thank you. Thanks for that answer. I think that helps a lot with getting to some of the things that the students are wondering about. I think we have some more questions, but I think I'll hold on to them for now because I know you guys have a lot more to talk about. So maybe we could get going on the next section.
So after our shore-based fall time success capturing and tagging ring seals and young bearded seals, then NOAA, Mike's outfit, was interested in trying to see if we could capture and tag adult or sub-adult, multiple-year, teenager adult bearded seals. And so we had generally the same crew that had worked on the other projects, with addition of a few new NOAA people and a few new Kotzebue people, to go out onto the ice and set nets in the springtime during breakup when the larger bearded seals are in Kotzebue Sound, which is the only time for the most part that they are here, in any numbers anyways, and try to use the hunting skills that people have for capturing these animals, with guns, and use the knowledge from the fall time netting work to try to see if we can make it work in the springtime. But I would say it's more challenging because it's never gets dark in the fall time. Most of our captures occurred at nighttime when it's a lot harder for the seals to see the nets. And the water is dirtier too, also at that time of year in the fall time where we were capturing ringed and young bearded seals. But here we are out where the sun never set. It was pretty much bright 24 hours, and also the water in a lot of places was crystal clear or close to it. So that made it a lot more challenging. Plus the people in the boats were right there. It wasn't like they were, we set a net and then walk away. You actually had to be out there with the boats and with the people in the sun, in the clear water, and try to get these seals to swim into the nets. And then I'll let Mike talk a little more about the firsthand experience.
Okay. Sure. Well, I'll just say that this is how learning happens. We make a plan, we test it, we see what parts work and what parts don't, and then we continue with the parts that work. We felt like we were doing, like we understood a good way to be able to capture young bearded seals. And so we decided to press our luck and try on large bearded seals, which, as Alex mentioned, are a lot more complicated, difficult, and obviously a lot heavier to capture. There was a group in Norway that had figured out how to capture adult bearded seals, but only the females. They would actually capture the pup, bring the pup onto the floe, and effectively use the pup as bait to bring the mom back onto the floe where they could catch the mom. They didn't have a method for being able to capture adult males, however. By applying the method that was developed in Kotzebue for pups, we were able to sort of expand that. We would see an animal hauled out onto a floe. We would drop these drift nets. Basically, now they're not attached to anything. They're just sort of free floating near the ice where the animal is. Our presence sometimes would disturb the animal so it would go in the water. It would see the net, as Alex mentioned, and as it went over to investigate, it might get flipper caught and then all of a sudden get wrapped up into the net where we could go and capture it. I'll say that what I just described makes it seem like it happened frequently and we were really good at it all the time, but the reality is that these are wild animals. They're used to being hunted, they're wary of people, and it's a difficult thing to do. But with perseverance and skill of being able to work with the hunters to be able to get close to the animals, their ability to work with nets, and everyone's ability to be open to new and innovative ideas, we were able to capture animals. We started recognizing that it was the seals' interest in the nets that ultimately brought them close to them. So rather than try and hide them all the time, for a while we would actually hang things that reflected light. Like I think we put a CD or a DVD on there hoping it would reflect sort of like a fishing lure to attract the animal. I'm not sure that that worked, but the point was is that we tried lots of things. We all had lots of ideas to be able to capture the animal. Once the animal was in the net, we were able to put it into a tarp that Alex actually, I think, helped to design that was later used as part of the stretcher. The tarp then was connected to the side of the boat where we drive the seal, basically like a sidecar, over to an ice floe where a big team of people would be able to pull this 400, 500 pound animal up onto the ice. At that point, we would be able to cut the net off of the seal and then use the stretcher and a bipod to weigh it, to measure it, and take all the samples and attach satellite tags in the same way that we did with young animals. So I can talk about this a little bit. Each one of these colors represents the locations of a different animal that was tagged as part of these studies. Remember, these are not pups now, these are subadults or adults. What we're looking at is actually the Bering Sea. So we're south of the Chukchi Sea now. You can see Gambel and Savunga, part of St. Lawrence Island. You can see Little Diomede there, which is right off of the Seward Peninsula. So that's the boundary between the Bering Sea to the south, which is mostly this image, and the Chukchi Sea to the north. What we're looking at now are the winter locations. So one advantage or one improvement that we made over the tags that we placed on the young bearded seals was, in addition to the tags that Alex mentioned that we glued onto the seal's fur, remember those tags can only last as long as when the animal next molts. So just a month later, eight or nine months later when the animal molts. We also placed a different type of the satellite tag, a smaller type of satellite tag called a flipper tag. And as you may be able to tell by the name, a flipper tag is a tag that's connected to the seal's rear flippers. There's a webbing in between their rear flippers that we're able to punch a hole, similar that you would for piercing your ear. Using that hole, we can actually attach a satellite tag to that hole. The advantage then is that satellite tag stays in for up to 3 or I think even 4 years once. So we can have repeated locations of an animal and repeated information on haul out from an animal. Unfortunately, these tags don't give us information on diving. They're just too small for that. The flipper, the tags that are glued on are larger. They're about the size of a deck of playing cards. And the tags that are connected to the flipper are quite a bit smaller, about the size of a USB thumb drive. Battery life is modulated so that we don't get records every day, but over time, we're still able to understand how the animal's moving. As I mentioned, these flipper tags stay on for years at a time. And so we have the unique ability to be able to track their movements year after year after year. And what we found, at least for male bearded seals, was something very surprising and something that we weren't expecting. And that's that at least three of the male bearded seals that we were able to track for 3 or more years returned to the exact same or nearly the exact same location year after year. Return to the exact same location in the Bering Sea in the winter, year after year. This behavior of returning to the same location year after year is known as site fidelity, meaning they have fidelity to the same location year after year. It suggests that perhaps they're using these locations to set up kind of consistent wintering or breeding sites. Some of these animals started identifying these locations when they were subadults, and by the time they were adults 3 years later, when their tag finally fell off, they were still using nearly the same location. This is not something that we expected to see, but something that's very useful for us as we understand again how these seals are able to use their habitat. And it shows also how widely these animals are moving between the Chukchi and the Bering Sea.
Yeah, I would just have to give a shout out to Hooper Bay too, because they're listed on there and I think they're listening in. So yeah. So the seals in Kotzebue Sound and the seals off of Hooper Bay are a lot of times the same seals.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to throw that out there.
Next slide.
Cool. Also, here we go. The NOAA was interested in part because of the success we had working together in Kotzebue Sound, cooperatively taking seals to bring some of the community-based, some of the hunters out onto their ships when they did seal capture and tagging out on the Bering Sea. And so some of our people that from Kotzebue were some of the first people to go out there because of the experience they had working on our seal capturing projects. And of course, Mike was out there with him, so maybe he'll say a few words.
Sure. So in addition to the bearded and ring seals that we've been learning about today, there are two other seals that are known as ice seals or ice associated seals. That's the spotted seal and the ribbon seal. These two seals are known to occupy the southern edge of the Bering Sea sea ice in the spring and early summer. In order to get access to the sea ice at that point, we use this ship called the Oscar Dyson to get out to the ice edge. There we will launch small rubber boats and we move quietly among the ice floes until we see a ribbon seal or a spotted seal that's hauled out onto the sea ice, usually sleeping or perhaps hanging out with its pup. We then quietly but quickly jump out of the boat with what is effectively a salmon landing net and capture the seal on the top of the ice. It's at that point that we're able to do much the same that we are with the bearded and the ring seals we've already discussed. We tag them, we weigh them, we measure them, we collect samples. We were fortunate to also be able to work with representatives and other hunters from other communities in and around the Bering Sea and from Kotzebue on some of these projects. So being able to share knowledge again in a different habitat on different species has proved invaluable in our ways of understanding the sorts of data that is being collected. And it's the discussions over the dinner table that I think are often the most useful. After the day is over, we're all sitting around talking about what happened, and that's when some of the real insights occur. So I have found that time working out there with folks from different cultures to be the most useful and rewarding.
Great. Well, that's great. We have time for just a few more questions because we're at about 10 minutes out from the end of our webinar here. But we did want to, Ms. Ravenscroft's class was wondering why the tracker on the bearded seal, the adult bearded seal, was on its head, whereas the other ones were on their backs.
So that's a good question. I'll say that we no longer put satellite tags on the heads of animals. So that's not something that we tend to do anymore. But the reason that we put them on the heads at the beginning for that project was these satellite tags can only transmit information to a satellite when the tag and the antenna itself is out of the water. It's more likely that the tag and the antenna will be out of the water if it's placed on the animal's head as the animal comes up to breathe. And so in an interest of being able to maximize our ability to transmit data, we put the tags on the seal's head. NOAA works with a group called the Alaska Native Ice Seal Committee with a number of representatives from the different regions. And through discussions with the Ice Seal Committee about our research, they recommended that we stop placing them on the head, recognizing that some seals use their head to crunch through thin ice in order to make breathing holes. And they thought that having a tag on their head might disturb that. So now we place the head on their backs or slightly near their necks. Most animals, at least in the spring, are fat, and when they're at the surface, their backs and the antenna can still be out of the water. And certainly right before their dive, as they curve into the water, the tag can be exposed to air in order to transmit data. So that was just one other example of communicating with other folks and changing our methods to the benefit of the whole project.
Great, that's very interesting. I have one safety related question before we move on to the last section, which is that Kirsten was wondering what is the cost of I was looking at Christine's question of how do you know if the ice is stable enough to stand on?
That's probably best a question for Alex.
Stand on it and see whether you go swimming or not. So generally you can tell by looking at it, but of course you also usually have a stick or a staff or a pole, and you know, you check it before you stand on it. But it comes with experience, but you have to be careful. No matter how experienced you are, you can never take the safety of ice for granted. And so anytime we're working with ice, we're always extremely cautious and careful to make sure that nobody goes swimming.
Right. Absolutely.
Very important. All right. I know that you guys have a couple more things to talk about, and we're running a little short on our time. So I'm going to move ahead, and you guys can talk really briefly about the ring seal study. And then.
Yeah, I for sure want to show the hearing. So,
yeah.
So we did another project later on using dogs that are able to locate seal dens and seal lairs using their nose the same way that polar bears do. And so a lot of times people have no hope at all of finding these because they're covered with snow and they blend in. By using a dog out of Kotzebue, we actually did that, and we plotted the locations of the breathing holes, the resting layers, and the birth layers of seals, in part to learn more about ring seals near Kotzebue, but also to train dogs that can be used in other projects and even for things like clearing roads out to development sites where they're drilling offshore to allow them to avoid crushing birthing layers and disturbing birthing layers. Next slide. And here's just pictures of that in action there, the dogs and the people out on the ice. Next slide.
That was a lot of fun. I really enjoyed that project.
Yeah. And related to that was we captured ring seals and put those flipper tags on, not the satellite tags, the flipper tags like Mike was talking about earlier. And I just wanted to show one of the ways that we captured seals on the ice. And this example was where they were coming up onto the ice to sun themselves in the springtime. And we would set this flexible hoop net over the hole and then tie it up with monofilament. So it's tied to that stick you see there, and then connect the monofilament to a copper lead that would be connected to a battery, which is connected to a radio transmitter. Next slide. Next slide. And there you can see we're crunching the net, connecting it, and then going up on the hill with a spotting scope and watching for a seal to come out. And then when we see a seal come out, we can send a radio signal to the transmitter, and it'll cause the battery to burn the copper lead, and the net will spring over the hole. Next slide. We only got 3 minutes left. And there's a ring seal captured. Next slide. And so one of the things we did was use our experience catching young bearded seals. And this is during when they were exploring for oil in the Chukchi Sea. And they needed to know more about herring and bearded seals. There hadn't been a live bearded seal to do herring studies, at least in the United States. And so we worked with the University of Santa Cruz in California, Long Marine Lab. And we captured seals here in Kotzebue and sent them down there. And then they're doing herring studies with them. Next slide. And here you can see one of the seals that we captured. And we'll show a little video. And what it's showing is the seal is being trained to push a lever when it hears the sound and push a different lever when it doesn't hear a sound. And that way, once the seal is trained to do that, that way they can adjust the sounds that the seal is hearing and try to understand how high of a sound and how low of a sound. And how loud of a sound and how soft of a sound the seal can hear, so they can use that information to understand the different kind of sounds and how they may affect the seal. So here we'll show the video.
Okay, so, and remember, this is going to mute you, so you'll have to unmute.
So you can see the trainer and the seal over there in the corner. And the trainer is telling the seal to go. They've already trained it to this point. And remember, this is a wild-caught seal here in Kotzebue. And so when the signal is present, they rest on that bar. You could hear the sound. And then it presses the button to show that it heard the sound. So bearded seals are smart. This is training that you would see with a dog or something, or a dolphin. So they're definitely smart animals. And this one was caught when it was like only about 5 months old, 5 or 6 months old, and sent down there. And this is probably about a year after that. And you see the signal was absent and it didn't press that button. So again, we're using our experience doing this project, not only for that project, but to provide that skill set to other opportunities, whether that's this training in California or whether it's having people go out in the Bering Sea and do additional work with NOAA.
Great. Those were both really interesting studies. I think that it shows how you can find out so many different kinds of information from the different studies that you do. We only have a couple more minutes left, and I was wondering whether you guys have any like parting words of wisdom for our students who are online about, because we did have a question from Zona from Hooper Bay asking, how do we become like you as a scientist? And so I was wondering whether you guys have any advice to give to our students before we finish off.
Well, use your experience growing up in the villages there, your outdoor experience, your hunting and fishing and camping experience, like I did, and your curiosity of all things natural, and just build on that and follow that. And that's the one thing that me and Mike both had in common, is we were outdoors kids and we were curious about everything, and we just kept following that pathway to here we are today.
I couldn't have said it better myself, Alex. The only other thing that I'd add is don't try everything and don't be afraid to fail. We learn the most when we make mistakes. That's how everybody improves. And everything is like that. So get out there and do it. Make a mistake, learn from it, improve, and keep going.
And we made lots of mistakes on these projects. Don't say that. But we never gave up.
That's right. Don't give up.
We don't give up. But there was a lot of mistakes. But that's just like.
Yes, and I think the main thing is just to be resilient and keep trying, because that's what I got from your guys' descriptions of the studies that you did. Because, you know, if something doesn't work, then you come up with other ideas and you just keep trying.
Yeah, just love of learning. Just love to learn and be curious and just keep doing that. Yep. That's what I keep doing every day. I still love to learn it. I'm still curious, and that's what keeps me going.
Well, thank you both so much for being our final presenters of this school year for NOAA Live Alaska. We really appreciate all of the stories and the wisdom and the experience that you've talked about. And thank you to all of our viewers for coming in as well.
No, thank you.
This was great. Thanks.
So thank you to everybody, and we will be back next September with another season of NOAA Live Alaska, so stay tuned, and we will also be sending out the recording to this webinar. Thanks very much. Bye-bye.
Bye.